morning. So we have a second job talk this week, and it's a great pleasure to, for those who don't know, to introduce Alexander Nestor, who, well, the majority of those present here actually know him because they even have taught him. He's our graduate, I don't remember which year actually, but
2009.
And one of those people who was actually very instrumental in defending the European University against the local government, whatever.
Not against.
Not against.
Together with the local government.
Instead of
defending.
In 2008. Yeah, but I can tell you a small story before Sasha will speak on the school choice with advice. When we first started thinking about opening this position in last summer, and I was meeting with Anna Bogomolina and Hervé Moulin during their first visits last July, and I said, like, we would be very grateful for recommending us someone strong in microeconomics, and they immediately came up with Sasha's name. But for some reason, I didn't kind of realize that the person who they were speaking about is Sasha. So I thought it's someone else by the name of Nestor. And especially Hervé Moulin was saying, like, no, you should look up for that guy because he has a very strong paper, actually criticizing my paper, and just I think he's a really, really promising candidate. And so that was, and after that I realized actually during the same talk, saying, like, actually I know Sasha because he's our graduate. And but that was the first time when, and then we actually met with Sasha for a first sort of informal interview or whatever talk in last July. So it's great pleasure to have him over, and great pleasure to listen to this paper. And currently Sasha is in Berlin, and also very instrumental, was very helpful in running European University alumni network meetings in Berlin. It was like the, words escaped me this morning. The association organized by the alumni of the European University was actually registered as a charity in Berlin, and Sasha was also very frequent attendee of those meetings that would happen in Berlin. So without further ado, just passing the floor to Sasha.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me here. It's a great pleasure. And now with this microphone connected to me, it's also a very big responsibility. Every word is recorded. Right. Unfortunately, the screens perhaps are not ideal to really see the talk because there will be many tiny details there. So I'm going to use whiteboard, and I try to explain everything very intuitively. Right. We won't go into too much details. And please feel free to ask questions in English or Russian, both is fine. It's a little bit more comfortable for me to speak about this in English because I don't have still the terminology for what I'm going to talk about.
Are you going to be lectures in microeconomics in Russian or in English?
I would prefer English, but with time I think we can also develop.
If you are.
Both is possible. I know that English is also an option, right? But all right. So, just let me start this technology here, so that I know the remaining time. Right. So today we are going to talk about the school choice problem. So basically, the problem here's just a short abstract of my talk. So the problem is the following: how to allocate seats in primary schools among students. It's going to be a theory paper. It's formally a mechanism design, matching market mechanism design, problem. So what I'm going to do, now I'm going to present you my idea of how it should be done. So I will present you an allocation mechanism that I developed in the paper. That's one contribution, so I study its properties. And the other contribution is I compare this mechanism against the two existing popular mechanisms. So the two existing popular mechanisms are written here. One is called immediate acceptance and the other is deferred acceptance. So you have two extremes. You have something immediate and then you have something deferred, you know, conditional. And then in the middle, my mechanism is somewhere in the middle. I will explain what exactly it means, and that's why I call it adaptive. So it's, you know, you might have heard of one of them, the deferred or the immediate acceptance. But so compared to these two mechanisms, the mechanism I propose has a strong combination of properties in two terms: in terms of efficiency, Pareto efficiency, and in terms of incentives. So it gives strong incentives for students to report truthfully their preferences, not to try to manipulate the mechanism, right? And the key idea why this is possible is that the mechanism that I propose requires more information from students. So students just report more information about their preferences as compared to the popular mechanisms. All right, so this is a brief abstract. If you didn't catch something, it's fine for now. So let me begin with the model. So I will present you the model just with these pictures. I think it is still visible, right? What I can't see, but if you can. So we have a two-sided matching market. We have supply and demand for education. On the one side, we have students. So these blue little circles, they are numbered 1, 2, 3, and so on, and so forth. And on the other side, we have schools. So schools are A, B, C, and so on. And schools have different capacity. So some schools are smaller, like A has just two seats, if you see it, right? And B and C might have more. So what characterizes students, for instance, student one? Student one has preferences over schools. If you don't see it there, so student one has preferences. He prefers school A over school B and school B over school C and so on, right? So this has strict ordinal preferences. What characterizes schools is something what we call priority. Like there on the picture, it is 1, 1, 5, and then 2, I don't know, 3, 4, doesn't really matter. So on the school side, this priority, first of all, is not strict. So the school A might be indifferent between several students, but it prefers these students over that students. So what priority is not a preference of the school. A priority is usually a legal requirement to give a higher priority to accept certain students prior to other students. So you can always think about the district school priority. If all students apply to, okay. So for instance, now in this picture, if all students apply, they want to go to A, and A school A has just capacity of 2, it would accept by law only these 2 students because they have high priority. So in the district school priority, all students within the district, they by law receive a higher priority than students outside of the district. Okay. So now the challenge is, given the information about students' preferences, this, and the information about this legal requirement, the priorities as we know them, the question is how to find who goes where. What is the matching? So who gets to study at which school? All right. And the way we approach this. It's by mechanism design. So what mechanism design is creating some box, some, you know, black box, which you feed with preferences and priorities, and here you get the matching. So the contribution of the paper is what exactly happens in this box. But it's important that the game structure is always the same. The game is that we tell students what the mechanism is. So, and then students report the preferences, and we get the final allocation. We also, in terms of preferences, we care only about students. We don't take priorities as schools' preferences. These are not preferences. So schools for us are just objects. Therefore, efficiency properties, incentives properties, we define only from the student's perspective. These are students who can manipulate or who can be, you know, better improved, but not schools. So we don't really care about schools. All right? Right, and to motivate this this design, why we think this is a relevant setting, I will briefly tell you about the story of of school choice, how it developed. So school choice is literally giving a right to parents to choose a school for their children. And it might be important per se. Traditionally there was no right, so you you had just one school, the nearest school usually, which had to accept your kid. But the initial intention was to introduce some competition in this market, so that schools compete in quality, and also students, you know, or parents try to find out what is the best for their children. But the problem is that this is not a normal market. There are no prices, there is no money, and there is no easy way how to match supply and demand. We know that these markets have various market failures, so there is a lot of miscoordination going on. Some students are left behind, others, then some schools have remaining capacity that is not filled because of miscoordination and so on. So the initial response to that was to add some priorities, so to add this structure in the problem, like this ones, right? So policymakers impose priorities, and in different cities they differ, but not so much. I mean, the laws, how these priorities are determined. And then the second important feature is the rule, the mechanism, how actually to use preferences and priorities and come up with the matching. So we take priorities as exogenous. We don't tackle this question. We just focus on the mechanism given certain priorities. And now the literature started with a paper by Abdul Qadir Oglu and Sonia. So it's a very influential paper, seminal paper. What they did, they just looked at the existing school choice systems from the mechanism design perspective. So they tried to identify what kind of mechanisms they have in place. And what they found is that in most cities in the US, and then most cities around the world actually, the mechanisms that are used are actually versions of one specific mechanism that they called Boston mechanism, because they first described it for Boston, but more formally it's called immediate acceptance. And not surprisingly, that was a very bad mechanism. So otherwise you wouldn't make a great paper out of it. So they really found that there is something really bad going on. And the main flaw in this mechanism is it's really horrible incentive properties. So students get, or parents, students get strong incentives to misreport their true preferences, to manipulate the mechanism. And we never like it, first of all, per se. But then it also, we just don't like it because we receive the data and we don't know whether it is true or not. We also don't like it because some students strategize better than others. So there are some fairness concerns. We also don't want this. So what they proposed to do, they proposed to use some what we call strategy proof mechanism, so non-manipulable mechanism. And the main competitor was the, so the first was immediate acceptance, and the second is deferred acceptance. That's what they proposed to use in the school choice. So deferred acceptance, you might have definitely heard of, because it is the famous idea by Gale and Shapley, the deferred acceptance algorithm, how to find stable allocations. So the idea had a huge success, both in the literature, there were many great papers, great follow-ups on that, but also among policymakers. So many cities changed the mechanisms after this contribution, starting from Boston, and then New York, and then other cities. But then later, So deferred acceptance is good in terms of incentives, but it was later realized that that it has some flaws in terms of efficiency. I will tell you exactly where they come from. So then deferred acceptance was also criticized. And in fact, sometimes immediate acceptance, if we take immediate acceptance, you know, it is a strategic game. It has multiple equilibria, right? It's very complicated. But sometimes all equilibria dominate the outcome of the deferred acceptance. So we should really prefer immediate acceptance to the deferred acceptance because of efficiency. So the comparison between the two mechanisms is not clear. Sometimes one is better, sometimes the other is better. Now, what I do in this paper, I try to solve this trade-off. You know, we have two options, they are not good, we know that, but what should we do? I propose to do two things. First of all, I want to elicit more preferences, not just ordinal preferences as here, and also to use a different mechanism that I call adaptive acceptance. And compared to these two, it has, compared to immediate acceptance, it has stronger incentive properties, and compared to deferred acceptance, it has better efficiency properties. So intuitively, we have some, so we have to elicit more information from students. I will tell you exactly what it means. I mean, more information meaning we need to know some cardinality of their preferences. It, not as before, you just report your ordinal preferences, but you would say, you can think about this as dividing 100 or 1000 points. So you give 60 to A, 40 to B, and so on. And this, of course, is costly. We get more information, and but it's not clear how to use this information. And the mechanism uses this information appropriately. So that's why it has good properties. So let me now tell you how the two traditional mechanisms work. All right. If you can read this, the procedure is just written there. I will briefly explain it in words. So, in the immediate acceptance, students report ordinal rankings of schools like this. And then there is some iterative procedure going on. In the first round, we first consider only the top-ranked schools. So, it is just students apply to these top-ranked schools. And then each top-ranked school accepts up to its capacity among the applicants, and according to its priority. And if there are some ties, you know, the priority I told you it's not strict. So there may be many students that are actually that have the same priority, but there is just one seat. So then we break ties at random. So again, students go to the top ranked schools. And then each school accepts up to its capacity according to priority and the tiebreaker. And then those students who receive the seat, who were accepted, they leave the mechanism and they're done. And others are rejected and they go to the second round. In the second round, the second top reported schools are considered. Then it continues, so the third, the fourth, and so on, until either all students or all seats are assigned. So here's a demonstration of how it works in the same example. Imagine that the students 1, 2, and 3 top-ranked school A, and students 4, 5, and 6 top-ranked school B. That's what I show with these dashed lines there. So what we do, we check the priority side. Let us start with school A. We see that students 2 and 3 have a higher priority than school A. That's why they accept it. And student one is rejected. So his line does not become bold, right? You see that. And then at school B, you see that there are just three applicants and three seats. So they all are accepted. All the accepted students leave the mechanism. Student one is left over. And in the next round, he applies to his second reported school, which is B. But B is already empty, right? So maybe you can see from this already that his truthful report was not optimal. He actually knew that he wouldn't get to A, and now he doesn't get to B either. So he wasted his turn. This again the description of the mechanism, and there are several flaws. First, the incentives, then also some outcomes in this equilibrium, some equilibrium outcomes, if we consider this as a strategy game, they're really bad in terms of efficiency and also the unfairness concerns that I mentioned before matter. Right, so people don't like immediate acceptance because it is unfair. Economists don't like because it is not efficient and it's incompatible. Politicians, though, like it very much because as a result of these incentives, students want to top rank safe schools. District school, for instance. If you know that you have a high priority at some school, you just top rank it because you get it for sure. There's no uncertainty. Or if there is some unpopular school, you know the demand will not be high, you also want to put it high in your ranking. So as a result, politicians are very proud of that, you know, 90% of students get their top choice. It is such a perfect system, everyone gets the top choice, and they don't care whether, you know, it was true top choice or it was just fake top choice. So here's the deferred acceptance, the other option. It works quite similarly, with just one main difference. When the students report top rankings, students report the rank audit list of schools, and I forgot to tell you one thing. We have to break priorities, we have to break ties in the very beginning in deferred acceptance. Deferred acceptance works only with strict rankings on both sides. We have a strict ranking on the student side, we also have to have one on the school side. So that's the first step. We first break the ties, and we do it randomly. So for instance, we do it 1 over 5 here and 2 and 3, just an example like that. So now we take as a strict priority of schools, and then we run the deferred acceptance algorithm. So in the first round, we consider all the top ranked schools, and then each school tentatively accepts up to its capacity, according to its new strict priority, and other students are rejected. Now, but this acceptance is only tentative, it's not final. We don't finalize the assignment yet. So in the second round, the rejected students apply to the second ranked schools, and now each school again tentatively accepts up to its capacity, according to priority, from previously accepted students and the new applicants. So the previously accepted were just tentatively accepted. So that's why there might be more students coming in, and we again have to look at the priority and see who is accepted and who is rejected. So if you're rejected first, second time, and so on, you go until you're accepted, and you stay there. And when there is no rejection anymore, so when everything is stabilizes, then we finalize the assignment. Here's how it works on the same example. So again, students 1, 2, and 3. The first step again, we break the ties in priorities. That's important. In all the schools, A, B, C, and so on. So instead of weak priority, we get a strict priority, and then. So first three students top rank A, the next top three students top rank B, and let's say again according to priority, school A accepts 2 and 3 and rejects 1. School B tentatively accepts students 4, 5, and 6. Correct? So now student 1 is rejected. In the next round, he applies to school B, and let's assume that priority at B, I just didn't put on the slide, is such that it's student 6, right, who is rejected, but 1, 4, and 5 are accepted, tentatively accepted at B. So you see, student 1 didn't lose any chance by not top ranking B, because he always gets a fair treatment in the next rounds. The seats are still there. Right, and let's assume that there are no more rejections, so everyone, so no more rejections happening in the economy, and then we finalize the assignment. So that will be the assignment. As you could see, the incentive properties are restored. Truth-telling is now a dominant strategy. But the problem is that we have to add too much randomness in the problem. The randomness comes from that we randomly break ties. And we have to do it because that's how deferred acceptance works. And now, when we break the ties, we then have to respect them. So, for instance, one and five, we could get 1/5 or 5/1. For the mechanism, it is the same. So it gives 50% chance to this and 50% chance to this. But for us, not necessarily. So if student one really wants to go to his top school, and student five is rather indifferent between school A and B, like this, you know, that's comparable. But for student one, it could be 90, 90, and 10. So for the mechanism, it does not matter, because the mechanism doesn't know this cardinal information. The mechanism only knows the ordinal information. And that's why it will randomly assign higher priority either to student 1 or student 5. That's where the efficiency losses come from. Because then we have to respect these priorities. We break ties, we get strict priorities, and then we have to respect them in the algorithm. Right? So this is where I get the idea for my mechanism. In my mechanism, the adaptive acceptance, students report their cardinal preferences. To be more formally correct, they don't report the cardinal preference, but they report this Feynman-Morgenstern preference. So if you don't know what it means, these are just preferences that satisfies a certain number of axioms. But for us, it is important that given these preferences, we know how each student evaluates lotteries, evaluates uncertain outcomes. So how does the student evaluate some chance to be accepted at A, plus some chance to be accepted at B, and so on? So we have some lottery. And given these numbers, we can evaluate the expected utility of the agent. All right? So, and if you think about this, this is quite natural. We even in the deferred and immediate acceptance mechanisms, we gave the students lotteries. We didn't give them the certain outcome, where do you go. But because we have this randomness, the students don't know how the ties will be broken, the outcome is uncertain. So you give students lotteries, but you don't ask for their preferences over lotteries. You just ask for their ordinal preferences. It tells you something. It tells you that, you know, some chance at A is better than the same chance at B. But if you have different chances at A and B, we don't know what the student prefers. So now, if we collect the preferences over lotteries and then give the outcome as a lottery, we can talk about efficiency, incentive, and so on, because now the problem is properly defined. We deal with the things we know about, with preferences over lotteries. So in the adaptive acceptance, first students report this point that reflect their preferences over lotteries. And then the mechanism has bits and pieces of this too. I will tell you now the procedure. So again, it's some iterative mechanism. And let me show you how it works. So I changed the example just a bit. First of all, let's look at student A. He gives 60 points to, student 1, he gives 60 points to A, 40 points to B, 5 to C, and so on, so smaller points further. And then priorities at A are now such that A is indifferent between students 1, 4, 3, and 1, 2, 3, and 4. So we need this to make the point. And let's assume that students 1, 2, 3, and 4 are actually those who top rank school A. All right, so what happens first is that, and to be specific, so we collect the preferences and students go home after that, right? So they wait until the black box tells them which school they have to go to. So students report it, and then we run this iterative procedure, run the algorithm. In the first round, as before, we consider the top-ranked schools, as it's shown there. So students 1, 2, 3, and 4, they top-rank school A. And other students, for instance, 5 and 6, top-rank B. And at this point, we evaluate the expected assignment probability at the top rank school, at the school the student applies to. So for student one, for instance, his assignment probability at A is 50%, right? You can see this because there are just four applicants and two seats. So also at this point, we can evaluate whether a student would prefer some other application. So student one could withdraw his application from A and apply somewhere else, top rank some other school. For instance, B. B has a remaining capacity. There are just two applicants and three seats there. So if A withdraws the application, or if one withdraws the application from A and applies to B, top ranks B, then he gets a seat for sure. So do you see this? So now the question is whether student one prefers a seat at B or 50%, one half of 60 chance at A, right? And it might be the case. So here in the example, it is of course simplified. Here we can see that it's not too simple. We also need to consider what does the student expects to happen next, because he applies to A still, but in the next round he expects to get something good. We don't consider this now. We just assume that the student one prefers to get a sure seat at B because it gives him utility higher than the utility at A. Right, so that's what the student would do. we do this on student behalf. So we just switch student one to school B. And then we check whether there are any more students wanting to switch in the whole economy. If there are some, we do the switches again and again. But let's assume that there are no switches anymore, so no one else wants to switch. And then we do the step as before. So we break the ties, and each school accepts up to its capacity among its current applicants according to its priority and the type rate. So here, student 1, 5 and 6, they are accepted for sure at school B, and then 2 and 3 are accepted because of the random type rating, are accepted at A. Student 4 is rejected, and this assignment is final. And then student 4 has to go to the next round, which looks exactly like that. So then we check the points for other schools, and we again have this switching procedure. Then when we arrive to some steady state where no one wants to switch, we break the ties and we clear the market step by step. So here's the formal description. That's just what I described you to. A bit more formal, right? So I told you that it has bits and pieces of the two mechanisms here. So similar to the immediate acceptance, we clear the market step by step. In each round, we break the ties. We assign some students. These students leave the market. Similar to the deferred acceptance, we have this switching procedure. If you apply in the algorithm, if you apply to some school and you have a very low chance there, it is the same, roughly speaking, as being rejected by the deferred acceptance. You know, deferred acceptance just tells you, because deferred acceptance has strict priorities, deferred acceptance tells you you are rejected, so you apply then to your next school and so on. And here you see that, no, I would prefer actually to be rejected. You see that the assignment probability is low, so you as a student in the algorithm, you just switch to another school. All right, so to complete this introduction, I brief you on the literature. So there are several strands of literature in this school choice field that the paper contributes to. Most importantly, there are several papers that identify different problems with the immediate acceptance. So the first three papers there, including the seminal, the first one, Abdul Qadir Ragun Samnas, 2003. And then there are three papers listed next, Dur, Harles, Menle, and Zoykin. Here they consider actually the same modification of the immediate acceptance. These three papers consider the following modification. It's called immediate acceptance with skips. Imagine that you were rejected in the immediate acceptance at the first round. Then you go to the next round, but there are no seats anymore, right? So you go to school B, but B is empty. So they think it doesn't make sense, and of course it's correct, to apply to B. So the student would then, if he applies to a school with no seats, he would go further and further down the list until he finally reaches the school with the remaining seats. So that's what SKIP stands for. And they find that this is a very good modification of the mechanism in terms of efficiency, incentives. Right, but the adaptive acceptance does this automatically. If you were unlucky in the first round, you go to the next round in the adaptive acceptance, and the next school that you top ranked was, for instance, the school D with no seats, you know that the utility you expect to get there is zero. So you would definitely want to switch, and the mechanism respects that. So the mechanism would switch you at some point somewhere, and it would switch you until you don't want to switch anymore. Right. So there are also papers that improve on deferred acceptance. Essentially, all these papers either identify these problems with tag breaking, as I explained it here, or they try to, or they come up with some tricks how to add less randomness, how to break less tags. So how to elicit a little bit of the cardinal information before. For instance, one paper just lets you to, so you report your ranking, and you also send a signal. You can signal one school. What it means is that if you are, if you know, that's exactly how the job market process for economists goes, but if you don't, so if you're competing for the same school at some point, and you send a signal, but others did not, then you get a higher priority. So, and you can signal just one school. It's not obvious how to strategize, how to find, you know, a perfect signal. It wasn't obvious for me either when I sent my signals. I think I wasted them, but this is a complicated game. But this is the idea is again the same. So you can by eliciting the signals, you can understand something about cardinality, about the intensities of preferences. Right. So then there is one paper that also considers school choice problem with cardinal reports. The difference is that they use a very famous mechanism. They just use a market mechanism, but with no money, with some pseudo money. So each school has a budget of, say, I don't know, 1,000 points. And then with these points, they report the preferences and they have these budgets. And then with these budgets, they can purchase probability shares in the market. Assignment probability shares, and then we find the valuation equilibrium. We find this price equilibrium, and it has very good properties because you know, we get good efficiency results, and all the students have the same budget, so it's also fair. So different from them, I propose an algorithm how to find this. So their paper is just an existence result. There exists a valuation equilibrium with good properties. I propose a constructive approach. So how exactly to find the mechanism, the allocation. And then also, if you forget about the priorities on the school side, so that's another strand of literature, very, very important one. If you forget about the priorities, then you get something that's called object allocation problem. There are no priorities, schools are just objects, and we want to find who gets what. And there are many impossibilities results in this literature. Here's maybe the paper of Hervé Moulin that Maxime mentioned, and here's my paper. I didn't think I criticized Moulin there. I thought I just contribute and add something to what he did. Right, so we are restricted by this impossibility results because the school choice problem is modification of the object allocation problem. So the possibility results tell you usually that we cannot get an ideal mechanism that is very fair, very efficient, and very incentive compatible. So we have to compromise on something. And that is no surprise that we don't get ideal properties here as well. I will tell you the properties in a minute. Yeah, right, but I show that we can improve upon the existing mechanisms here. So this completes the introduction. It was extended because the initial talk was planned for 90 minutes. I won't be able to go into details, I hope you don't mind, and I believe you don't. Just one thing that I want to. So this is.
Sorry.
Yeah.
May I
sure.
ask a question about different mechanisms.
Yeah.
What is about a different acceptance mechanism where we swap the roles of schools and students, because we can do so and it should be different from.
Right. So what you are saying, we should use deferred acceptance with schools proposing.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right. Yeah, we could do this.
Is it better or?
Yeah. So.
Is it comparable to?
Yeah. Right. So you might know that if we have school proposing, we get an outcome that is favorable for schools and harmful for students. Right. We. They can be perfectly ordered, the outcomes in the deferred acceptance. So each school would prefer actually to use that, but each student would prefer to use the student proposing. But we do not care about the preferences of schools, right, in this problem. If it was the other case, so we cared about the preferences of schools, for instance, we cared about the, I don't know, how schools perform, and we didn't care about the individual preferences of students, that would make sense. We just make schools get better students, get a better allocation of students, but we would harm students. That's what you had in mind.
Another right? question
okay.
is about a competitive mechanism that you mentioned. As I know, at least in the
okay.
case,
I think it's better to ask a question after because it's not 45 minutes for introduction.
Yeah, but you're welcome to ask.
If you have any essential questions, I don't understand. Okay,
No, I can ask it later.
Sure, you're welcome. So, here's the model. I just want to emphasize here that we do not put restrictions on the cardinal preferences of students. So it means that the utility that the student gets from a certain school is not restricted in amplitude, you know, by some threshold. Also, we do not restrict the sum of the utilities, so we do not use any normalizations. We just need the utilities to understand the preferences of all lotteries. Yeah, the only thing we do restrict is that if a student is not matched to any school, he gets an outside option, maybe, I don't know, private school, or he goes to the next round, and we impose zero utility on this outside option. So the utility of not being matched is zero. That's the normalization that we use. All right, so in order to compare the mechanisms, I will present you two extreme simplified cases that differ in priority structure. So the first case would be, sorry, I think I can go directly to the results. I'm sorry that I'm skipping. It's not not the best way I could do it, but right. So in order to compare the three mechanisms, I first consider the setting where schools are completely indifferent between students. They have no priorities. Everything is done by tie-breaking. Then that is what I call no priority case. Then we go to the strict priority case where opposite schools have strict priorities from the very beginning. And then for a general case of weak priorities, so there are some priorities, but they are not strict, I compare the mechanism using a simulation. All right. So let's begin first with the case where there are no priorities and students have the same ordinal preferences. It is a simplified example, a simplified case, which models the situation when preferences of students are very correlated. So they see that one school is really better, you know, in objective quality, the other is worse, and so on. For this simplified case, we get strong results for more general, they're not that strong, but let me begin with this one. So the result is that in this case, adaptive acceptance dominates deferred acceptance. The outcome of adaptive acceptance, interim dominates deferred acceptance outcome. What interim here stands for is that it is this dominance is evaluated at the point of time where you, as a student, you know your preferences, but you don't know the preferences of others yet. You just know the distribution. You know approximately the expected demand. So the intuition behind this is illustrated with this example. There are just in the example three schools with one seat, with unit capacity, and three students with common ordinal preferences. But you see, student three is more indifferent between schools A and B. So these are the utilities of students compared to students one and two, right? So what does deferred acceptance gives us? What is the expected assignment? The deferred acceptance cannot really differentiate these students. So the deferred acceptance gives each of them an equal assignment probability. Now, the adaptive acceptance proceeds as I showed before. So first students apply to A, but then we check whether students want to switch. They want to, they would prefer to change the application. And that's exactly what happens with student three. So he prefers to, if he applies to A, he gets, small expected value. But when he switches to B, he gets a seat for sure. And as a result, we get this expected assignment. And each student here gets an expected value of 4, while here they get each get less. So each here gets 10 over 3. So student 3, when he switches, he also lets others benefit from that, because others increase their chances for object A that they really want. All right. Next, we check the incentive properties of adaptive acceptance in this case. So the question is the strategy proof? No, it is not, because students can potentially manipulate the environment. So the strong incentives, I just give you an abstract answer. The strong incentives of students to manipulate are respected, because that's where the mechanism tries to switch them. But still, there is some scope for manipulation. Yet, if there are any incentives to manipulate, in this case, they disappear as the market grows large. So specifically, we get a problem, for instance, in this example, where some student wants to manipulate the mechanism, wants to misreport the preferences, and then we enlarge the market. So we replicate each student, we replicate each seat, we keep the number of schools constant, and after several replications, all the incentives disappear. Then manipulation can only harm you. So let's check this example. It looks exactly as before, but just student two is even more indifferent between school A and B compared to other students. So as a result, both students two and three would prefer to switch to school B. Right, so when they first apply to A, we ask, we check who wants to switch. There are two students who want to switch. And then if one of them switches, the other one doesn't want to switch anymore. So if student three, for instance, switches to B, he gets a seat at B for sure, because student two does not follow, does not switch after that anymore. So the question is, how do we pick the student to switch? Here we use a choice rule that I call maximum benefit. It is one of the choice rules I consider. So how, if we have several students that we want to switch, that prefer to switch, how to pick one of them? And it just says that we should pick a student who benefits more than others. And here it is student 2, because he is more indifferent, so he would be, you know, just a little bit less happy with B, but his expected utility, so his benefit is higher than the benefit of student 3. So we pick student 2 to switch. Student 3 doesn't want to switch anymore, but student 3 does not like it. So student 3 in this assignment gets only half of A. So it is 3, utility of 3. Although if he switched before and 2 did not follow, he gets 4. So what effectively happens is that 3 has an incentive to manipulate. He either can pretend to be even more indifferent than student 2, or he can directly top rank school B. Just say, you know, B is my top choice. So that is type of the incentive to manipulate that remains in the problem. But imagine what happens once we add more and more replicas of students in this problem. So specifically, let's see that. Let's look at the following case. So 3 switches to B, and then we add more and more students of type 1, 2, and 3. And eventually, after we add many enough students, and student 3 becomes marginal, not really influential, so the environment becomes the same. We get the same problem multiplied by many times, right? We get the same problem, then we check who wants to switch. These are students 2 of type 2 who want to switch. We will switch them. And if the influence of the student 3 who deviated first becomes very small, all students 2 will switch. So we get the same problem, we get the same outcome. All students 2 switch, and now the student 3 who manipulated and maybe top ranked school B in the first place, he is harmed by that. So he did a manipulation that is harmful, because now he would actually prefer to go back to A. It gives him a higher utility.
That's the number of replications that we need depend on the utility.
Of course, it depends on the specifics. So here
it can be very large. Almost entire.
Yeah, yeah. Here specifically, it would depend on how much the difference is between. Between students 2 and 3, so between the utilities of these students, because we need really to push the student 3 who manipulated back, and it depends on his utility. That's true. Although what is also true, we don't need infinity. This is not that incentives disappear in infinity; they disappear after many enough replications. All right. So compared to adaptive acceptance, immediate acceptance does not have this property. Even in the very large markets, there are still strong incentives to manipulate. All right, so for...
Can you just wrap up within like 5 to 10 minutes?
Yeah, I think I have 10 minutes and that's what I'm going to do. Right. Right, so for the arbitrary rankings, I have two axiomatic appearances of the mechanisms. What they roughly say is that especially the second one, the result 2, what it says is that these mechanisms are not perfect, so they have some efficiency losses, adaptive acceptance, deferred acceptance, and so on. But compared to deferred acceptance, adaptive acceptance has fewer cases where it has strictly fewer cases where it has efficiency losses. So by set comparison, we know that the set of problems where adaptive acceptance has efficiency losses is just smaller than the one where deferred acceptance has efficiency losses. So we have this imperfect set comparison of the two mechanisms. Next, in the strict priority case, it's quite it is much simpler, because here deferred acceptance and adaptive acceptance coincide. They induce the same matching. They have different algorithms, different procedures, but the outcome is the same. And because of that, we know already the good properties of deferred acceptance. So now adaptive acceptance is strategy proof. It is, and what is also important, the comparison to the equilibrium outcomes of the immediate acceptance. This is the case in which adaptive acceptance dominates all equilibrium outcomes of the immediate acceptance. So both in terms of incentives and efficiency, adaptive acceptance is and deferred acceptance are better than immediate acceptance. If schools have strict priorities, that's the case we consider here. There is a single example, but we can talk later, I can show it later. And then for arbitrary priorities, I run simulations. What I do specifically, I simulate a square city, one by one. And then I randomly locate 100 students here. After that, I randomly locate with uniform distribution. After that, I randomly locate 10 schools. And then based on the Euclidean distance, I define the district. So which student belongs, each student belongs to the school that is nearest to him or her. And each school has a capacity of 10. So the total capacity is sufficient, but of course some schools have to accept more, some less. So that's how the priorities are defined. There's this district school priority I told you about before. And the preferences are defined from, they have three components. The first component is the distance. So students prefer the schools that that are closer to them. They don't want to travel far in the city. And then there are two components that are represented, you know, the intrinsic personal taste of students. One component is correlated, it's the same for everybody, it's common preference, it's perfectly correlated. And the other component, that is called ZIS, is individual, it's your intrinsic preference. You might prefer some school, but not necessarily others share your opinion. So we have these three components in the utility of a student for certain schools, and we add them with different weights. And then for different combination of these weights, I simulate the economy and I find the final allocation. Then I do it many times to see some consistent results, and that's what I get. So I compare adaptive acceptance and deferred acceptance. I don't consider immediate acceptance because it has multiple equilibrium outcomes. It's not clear how to find what exactly happens in this case with immediate acceptance. So first of all, this graph, on the horizontal axis you have this correlation parameter alpha, so how correlated, either they're completely uncorrelated, the preferences, or they are very correlated, perfectly correlated here. And on the vertical line you have the number of students who prefer adaptive acceptance over deferred acceptance, minus the number of students who prefer otherwise. So you have a net number of winners under adaptive acceptance. And this number is always positive, not surprisingly maybe, but the numbers are rather high. So out of 100 students, there are on average approximately 15 or so students that strictly benefit. And the ratio, typical ratio, is 4 to 1. For each 4 students that prefer adaptive acceptance, one would prefer deferred acceptance. So what we do next, we add up the utilities of these students to find the magnitude. So now we consider utilitarian welfare. Here I plotted just for zero transportation costs. So this, just to give you some thresholds, so this is the minimum welfare. It is the result of the welfare minimizing assignment. This is, all these points are very bad assignments. I found them combinatorically. And this, the upper bound is the welfare maximizing assignment. So you cannot do better than this. So the green line is the deferred acceptance line. You see that it does already pretty well. And the red line is the adaptive acceptance. So again, we see that adaptive acceptance consistently improves upon deferred acceptance in terms of welfare. And depending on the specification, this improvement can be large. So this is what I call the restored welfare loss or relative welfare gain. So how much of the welfare loss of the deferred acceptance can be restored by adaptive acceptance. And it is on average around 20-30%, and it goes up to somewhat 45% for different specifications of the of the parameters of the weights. So yeah, that was the last result. So just to wrap up, for different cases of the problem, I have theoretical results in terms of incentives. So I know that sometimes adaptive acceptance is strategy proof, sometimes it is approximately strategy proof. I don't know how it behaves in general. I conjecture that the incentive properties are also strong, something like approximate strategy proofness, but I haven't been able to prove it yet. And in terms of efficiency, the adaptive acceptance consistently performs as good as the best of the two. So it ranks high in any case when we can compare the mechanisms. So here's the conclusion. I introduced a mechanism that takes care of the intensities of preferences, and that makes it possible to get both strong incentive properties and efficiency properties. And besides, one can also say that the mechanism is more justified in Plato's or Aristotle's sense. So what these guys taught us is that you should always treat equal people equally and unequal people unequally. We thought that students that have the same ordinal preferences are equal, but they are not, right? What they also told us, you should treat unequal people unequally in respect of their similarities and differences. And we know that the people are actually different in terms of their true preferences, so we should give them a fair treatment. I would be happy to tell you more about what are the open questions, but they're just written here, and what I think how this mechanism can be implemented. Just one last final statement. I think partially this mechanism can be implemented already now in the following sense. If we use immediate acceptance today, and this is the case with most of the cities still, it can be actually the mechanism that is used in St. Petersburg since last year. I don't know, it's not clear exactly what they have been using. But if you use this mechanism today, and this is very intuitive mechanism, I suspect that it's something like that that they use, you can just let students or parents voluntarily report something what they know about their preferences. For instance, you can think about the 239 school and 30 school or some other good schools. And you would, as a parent, you would say, I'm rather indifferent between, these schools, I just want to get to some good school. Then you have some good schools in your district, and you would also say, I'm rather indifferent between this, where I get, I just want to get somewhere. And then you have something else, the schools that you prefer less. And that will be already sufficient for us as mechanism designers to improve upon the assignment. We just know more about your preferences, not just your ordinal preferences, but also some intensities. So by implementing this mechanism step by step, you just voluntarily allow parents to report what they know, we can eventually converge from immediate acceptance to adaptive acceptance.